Good morning. Welcome to everyone in person and online to Storm Lake United Methodist Church. I'm Reverend Dr. Melanie Hauser. I'm the chaplain over at Buena Vista University. I'm filling in for Pastor Kiboko, who is out for a little while, and we're just grateful you're all here to worship with us on All Saints Sunday. I'm going to turn it over to Marjean and let her do all the announcements.
Good morning. I want you all to please sign the attendance books. We always like to have your last name, first names of those attending, and any other information you would like us to have. Giving envelopes are here, so for those of you who do still use them, they are in the narthex. If you would like to start using giving envelopes, contact me in the office. We're still waiting on a lot of pledge cards. We'd appreciate those being in so that the finance committee can take off on their job. All Saints, if you are here for a member of your family for All Saints today, make sure that you come up and take their candle home with you. Glenn Hendrickson is going to be here November 21st. Is his picture up there? Somewhere? Anyway, this is a special request from Bev Schmidt, and she's been telling me about him for a couple of years now. It sounds very exciting. He plays the piano, and I guess talk to her if you need more details. But we hope you can all come. That is Thursday, the 21st, 6:30. So we have a member here who is celebrating a birthday. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about him. I did this once before a few years ago, but just to remind you, Bob North is who I'm talking about. So Bob has been a longtime member here at Storm Lake United Methodist Church. He has served on church boards over the years. Every Sunday morning, he's the man who comes in and unlocks the doors and makes the coffee. Then he usually locks the doors when church is over. He makes breakfast for the United Methodist Men meetings. He has been a confirmation mentor. He is a youth group leader. He has taught adult Sunday school. He is an old car enthusiast. He continues to bowl and golf. And my favorite, he's a former professional roller skater. So Bob's family is celebrating him this afternoon, as many of us as who can attend, from 2 to 4 today in the Family Life Center. Big party for Bob North. Okay, it's time to recognize others that have birthdays. It's not just about you, Bob. So birthdays coming this week are Dave Kaufmel, Braden Lyle, Kevin Scuffum, Aaron Johnson, Ashley Scuffum, Lori Wilcox, and I'm going to include Hank Svensson because he was not here his birthday week. So if you would please help sing Happy Birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Now, if you would please stand and join in the opening hymn for All the Saints, number 711.
For all the saints who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the world confess, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Thou wast their rock, their fortress, and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain in the well-fought fight. Thou in the darkness drear there one true light. Alleluia, alleluia. Oh, may thy soldiers faithful, true, and bold fight as the saints who nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Alleluia, alleluia. Oh, blessed communion, fellowship divine, we feebly struggle, thy glory shine. Yet all are one in thee, for all are thine. Alleluia, alleluia. And when the strife is fierce, the warfare long, steals on thee the distant triumph song, and hearts are brave again and arms are strong. Alleluia, alleluia. From earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl streams, in the countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, alleluia, alleluia.
Please join me in the call of worship that should be read responsibly. Make a joyful noise to the Lord of all lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing.
Know the Lord who made us is God.
We are the Lord's. We are the people of God, the sheep of God's pasture.
Enter God's gates with thanksgiving. Stand God's courts with praise.
Give thanks and bless God's name.
For the Lord is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever. God's faithfulness to all generations.
Please join in the opening prayer.
Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son Christ our Lord. Wrap your arm around us as we come before you. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Together, let us pray. For the people of this congregation, both those here in person and online today, and those who have gone before us, God, may we be a light in this world, and may people be drawn to you by the Holy Spirit they see in us. Lord, in your mercy, for those who suffer and those in trouble, we pray especially for those who are lonely, whether they are at home, in a nursing home, or in prison. Holy Spirit, be their companion on this journey and let them see your unfailing love. We pray for those who suffer from mental health challenges, especially as we enter this winter season of darkness. Be with those with depression and remind us to reach out to those around us. Lord, in your mercy, for the concerns of this local community, we pray especially for the wide variety of people who live here, both old and young, extroverts and introverts, people of all nations and races. May all in this community feel like they belong as beloved people created in the image of God. We pray for our city leadership, for our police department, and for all those who work together to make the tapestry of Storm Lake a beautiful thing to behold. Lord, in your mercy, for the world, its peoples, and its leaders, we pray especially for the national and local elections in our country this week. God, you have worked through every type of leader in the past, both those who worshiped and followed you and those who did not. Remind us that our trust is not in governments or elected officials, but in the name of the Lord our God. Heal the divisions in our land that have been widened by divisive rhetoric. Teach us to love one another and pray for those in leadership, regardless of who they are. Lord, in your mercy, all these things we ask in your name, Jesus the Christ. Amen. I would invite the children up for a children's moment. Yes?
The Bible tells me so, little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Oh, wow. It's so nice to see all of you here. Thank you for coming this morning. I do have a couple of announcements while we gather a few more children. There is no one in the nursery this morning, but the nursery is open. So if you want to bring your child to the nursery and stay with your child, you may. The other announcement I want to make is that on Election Day, if you do not have a ride to vote, please call the church office and we will make some arrangements to make sure that you get there to vote. Okay, what a special Sunday. In just a minute, we'll take care of our dollars, okay? This is a special Sunday in our church. I want you to look up here. We have lots of candles, and each one of these candles represents a person who has died this year. How many of you have had somebody that you love die? Okay, probably most of you, and if you haven't experienced that, you will at some time. You know, when somebody we love dies, we can be sure that they are Jesus, with Jesus, because Jesus said, No, you're way too young to die, but sometimes we know people who have died. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you, a wonderful place, so that you can be where I am. So we can know when our loved ones die that they are with Jesus in a very wonderful and a very happy place. Now, sometimes we're still sad because we wish we could talk to them and we wish we could touch them again. But I have good news for you. You can still get a message to somebody who is in heaven with Jesus. When you're praying to Jesus, you tell Jesus what you want that person to know. Maybe you want to tell them how much you love them. Maybe you want to tell them that you miss them. Maybe you want to ask for forgiveness for something you said to them while they were here on earth. You can do that. Tell Jesus, and Jesus will make sure they get the message. Isn't that happy to know that you can still communicate with somebody in heaven through Jesus? A lot of times I wake up in the morning and I say, Jesus, Just tell my mom and dad how much I love them and how much I appreciate all they did for me when they were on earth. And if there were times when I wasn't as kind as I should have been, please tell them to forgive me. So those are the things we can still do. And it makes us feel close to our loved ones. The Bible says that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, a great cloud of saints, people that have died, that have gone before us. So our loved ones are not that far away from us. And we just need to remember they're in a happy place with Jesus. Henry, did you have something to say? No, okay. Just stretching, huh? Okay, well, you know, that is such good news. I think we need to thank Jesus for that. So let's have humble hearts and serious minds as we come to Jesus with a prayer. You can repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Thank you for making a place for me in heaven.
Thank you for making a place for me in heaven.
Thank you for taking care of the people I love who have died. Thank you for taking care of the people I love who have died. In Jesus' name I pray. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for coming today.
Please join in the prayer of illumination. Lord,
open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
The scripture reading is from Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 through 33. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. Let him sit alone in silence. When he has laid it on him, let him put his mouth in the dust. There may yet be hope. Let him give his cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults, for the Lord will not cast off forever. But though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not willingly afflict or grieve the sons of men. Here ends the reading.
Would you pray with me? Lord, open our spiritual ears to hear and our spiritual eyes to see your word today. May we weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who rejoice, that we might better reflect your presence in this world. Keep our eyes fixed on you and our hearts searching for you in the midst of all that life has to offer. We pray in the name of God the Father, our Creator, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, our Sustainer. Amen. My social media feed this past summer was heartbreaking. These days, this week, it's downright hard. There's a lot more hurt expressed than hope in my social media feed. I don't know about yours. This summer, I almost couldn't bear to watch as I scrolled past friends, students, colleagues, and churches I love in places like Spencer and Cherokee, posting pictures of their flooded basements, their piles of ruined belongings beside the side of the road, their treasures and memories forever sodden from the floods. I felt helpless, knowing no matter how many flood buckets I packed or how much help I provided, it would never replace what was lost. I was in Spencer the night it began to flood. We stayed in the basement of Grace United Methodist Church preparing for the Walk to Emmaus retreat that didn't happen. Less than 24 hours later, that basement would be flooded nearly to the top. On Saturday, it became apparent that things were getting bad quickly, and we left as soon as we could. As I tried road after road, searching for a route that wasn't underwater, it took me almost 4 hours to find a way home to Storm Lake that wasn't submerged at some point. This was all me watching from the outside. If I felt hopeless from my dry house and my dry town of Storm Lake when I got home, I can't imagine the feelings that pulsed and still pulse through the veins of Spencer. Tragedies like this make us ask the tough questions in life. Why do bad things happen to good people? Did we do something to deserve this? What kind of a God do we really serve if he causes, or at the very least, allows this kind of destruction? Where is God in the middle of all this? Can we even hear or see or trust God anymore? Why? If you read the book of Lamentations in times like these, you can really identify with God's people. Their city had been ransacked by the Babylonians and razed to the ground. This wasn't just any city, mind you. This was the place promised to Abraham, their forefather, as the holy ground, the promised land, where God would place his people and prosper them. This was the place where God would build the holy temple and God would dwell with their people. No longer would God seem far off. No longer would God's presence reside temporarily in a portable tabernacle. The Hebrew people had lived into all the blessings God had promised. They were fruitful and multiplied. They were rescued as slaves from the land of Egypt. They had been brought to this holy and promised land where they could dwell in peace without looking over their shoulder constantly. They were led by kings like David and Solomon, who, with all their flaws, still led their people in worship of God in Jerusalem, the place their ancestors could only dream of. This was paradise until it wasn't. From these people who knew the depths of despair, we are blessed with laments. These five chapters written as poetry gave words to the pain of God's people. The poems of Lamentations have an ordered and a linear structure in contrast to the disorder of grief and pain. They are written mostly as acrostics, where each line starts with a different letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Rather than feeling like their suffering is pointless and chaotic, the words of these laments recognize and honor the anguish of people amid despair. It restores a kind of quiet human dignity to their suffering. Each of the five poems of Lamentations has a theme that lends to the overarching order of the book. In the first poem, Jerusalem is personified as the daughter of Zion. It goes on to describe her grief and shame and compares the city's destruction to the death of a loved one. Notice that it doesn't hold back or water down emotions. It doesn't pretend things really aren't that bad. There is no comparison of tragedy downplaying the destruction of Jerusalem because someone else or some other people has it worse. There is just pure, raw grief in that moment, in that situation, with those people. There is a call for God to look on their distress to see how broken they are. The second book focuses on God's character. The fall of Jerusalem had a distinct cause, and it was the result of the abandonment of God and their laws by God's people. Not every tragedy is directly a result of the action of the people involved, but this particular tragedy in Lamentations was. God's people had turned away, and God did not sweep it under the rug. When they looked at the character of God, they recognized that the divine wrath they were experiencing was not a result of God's random, volatile anger, but instead was based on God's justice. One of the best characteristics of God is that they are unchanging and true to their word. This was not a sneak attack by a God who hadn't warned the people. This was a God carrying out the justice they promised from the beginning. In a way, this justice is comforting. It reminded the people that the God they served was dependable and would keep their word regardless of the circumstances. And this leads us to the third poem where our passage today comes from. In the throes of grief and despair, God's people find a seedbed of hope. Because God is faithful in their judgment, God will also be faithful in their other promises. The God who doesn't change, who isn't fickle like people, will be faithful to save. Drawing on language from other laments in the books of Job and Psalms and Isaiah, God's people cling to hope. Did you catch it in our reading today? The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Even when it looks like all hope is lost, the people remember that God's love and mercies never end. They are not a people without hope because at the end of the day, they still worship and serve and belong to a faithful God. They remind themselves that sometimes you have to wait in grief and ashes to see a glimpse of God. But they cling to that hope as to a lifeline. At the end of this chapter, they answer one of our hard questions with the line, God does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. God does not cause arbitrary tragedy and destruction. God is not the source of their pain, but their hope amid all of it. God has let his people suffer the natural consequences of their actions, but God has not left them. Now, I would like to tell you that the Book of Lamentations wraps up everything in a neat bow at the end, and we all find out the answers to our hard why questions. But alas, there are some things that will hang unanswered until we meet God face to face. The last poem leaves us hanging with a paradox. God is our king and reigns forever. Therefore, our hope is in him. At the same time, we ask why it feels that God has forgotten and forsaken us. Is it because God has rejected us? These are real unanswered questions, but somehow the people find hope in God even when they feel abandoned. It is still worth the risk to put their hope in God. I have to tell you, after all that, Lamentations is one of my favorite books of the Bible, as odd as that sounds. I'm grateful because laments in Scripture can give us words to emotions that we have trouble expressing. Instead of glossing over pain, laments sit with you in your pain. We live in a culture that doesn't do a very good job of grieving. Other cultures make room for mourning rituals. Friends and family might sit with the grieving person for a week or more in honor of their loss. Many cultures encourage those in mourning to wear clothes of a specific color or type to indicate their grief for a year or more. What do we do in our culture when someone has died? This might sound familiar. We bring a casserole. We go to the visitation. We sometimes go to the funeral. We might give the grieving person a week off from work to handle the practical matters around death, and then we go back to the way things were and largely expect the grieving person to do the same. 2 weeks to the day after Spencer flooded, one of my best friends died suddenly. She was a vibrant person who, despite the fact that she was 78 and Catholic, was preaching in all the United Methodist and Presbyterian and UCC churches in the little country churches around us, who were without pastors or who needed pulpit supply. She preached the week before she died. This friend, who was doing amazing work for God, was suddenly gone. We finished selling the last of her earthly things by the end of the summer, but I am nowhere near done with my grieving, and I have a lot of unanswered questions for God. We as a culture are uncomfortable around death, whether it is the death of a person, the death of a dream, or the loss of a house and its contents. We are people who like to be helpful, to do something to relieve distress. As humans, we naturally want to fix the problem. Sometimes the problem is bigger than any of us can wrap our heads around. That is the time when laments are our friends. In God's word, God has given us room to be fully human with all our emotions. God is not scared of our anger or frustration or helplessness or anguish. God welcomes us as we are, as our true, authentic selves. When life for you or others is more than anyone can bear, don't run away. Don't offer words that minimize the grief. I detest platitudes around death or tragedy like everything happens for a reason. That is bad theology and usually not very comforting. Sometimes stuff just happens and there is no reason. Sometimes the reason is that we live in a fallen world where tragedy and sin still have a stronghold. Instead, I implore you to become comfortable in the uncomfortable. Sit with yourself and your friends, knowing that you have no power to fix anything. Let your presence be enough, even without words. Put your hope in God and trust that in God's timing, if you sit and wait in the pain, God will light a way through. Life doesn't go back to being the same, but there are eventually ways forward through this life. Today, we celebrate All Saints Sunday, where we remember those who have gone before us to heaven. There have been some hard deaths here this year. The mothers of young Sudanese boys should not have to bury those children before themselves. People who were pillars through many generations in this church have gotten to go to heaven before us. Grief is complicated. I have wept at some funerals, not because I missed the person, but because their celebration of life made my yearning for heaven so much stronger. This world that we live in is only our temporary home. It is full of sin and darkness and frustration and brokenness. Yet, we do not live as a people without hope, because we know that no matter what happens on this earth, this is not the end. We worship a God who has already written the end of the story, and God wins. Pastor Kiboko would say, touchdown, right? Sometimes grief looks like lamenting and celebrating at the same time. We lament for ourselves and at the same time celebrate that those who we love are healthy and healed and whole. My friend Carrie no longer has to live in constant pain because of the polio that attacked her body when she was a child. So today, this All Saints Day, we get to live in the paradox of the moment, knowing that in pain there is still hope, because the God we serve is faithful and will not abandon us. Remember those you love who have died. Let yourselves lament, my friends, because in the lamenting, there is healing. As you lament and celebrate and heal, may the God of all hope and peace fill you with love as you trust in them. Amen. We're going to have a chance now to honor our faithfully departed, those who have left us, and celebrate those who have already made it to heaven before us on All Saints Day. So I'm going to invite Katie Brosted to come forward and lead us.
Months or years have passed, and still we feel near to them. Our hearts yearn for them, though our grief has softened. There is a duller pain that abides. We see our loved ones now with the eyes of memory. We remember them with gratitude and bless their names. Our scripture readings are from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and chapter 11, verses 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that is so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance in the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Please join me in prayer.
Almighty God, both of the living and the dead, we praise your holy name for the blessing of life and eternal life. We name our loved ones before you who have finished their courses in faith and are present with you. Hold them and hold us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today we read the names, ring a bell, and light a candle for each member of this, your family, the church, who have died since last All Saints Day 2023 to the present. We have celebrated their lives by services of death resurrection. We also light an extra candle representing the lives of other loved ones, friends, and military remembered who have also celebrated the promise of resurrected life through Jesus Christ. Lois Bosworth. Joseph Dack. Phyllis Francis. Charles Gustafson. Harold North. Frank Pop. Barb Seiler. Tim Staten. Aletha Steffen. Our military and friends departed. I will now read the memorial designations for the cause of Bless. Carol Miller. Handbells, Stan Quick. Sanctuary sound and cameras, Craig Bosset, Elaine Boyd, Frank Pop, Dot Sathoff. For the youth programs, Wally Johnston, Harold North, Frank Pop. The Friendship Fund, Wally Johnson. Food distribution, Harold North, Frank Pop. The Bridge of Storm Lake, Wally Johnson, and miscellaneous in memory of Harold North, Stan Quick, in remembrance of all who have passed away since November 1st, 2023.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Would you join me in the congregational prayer?
O God, we thank you for the salvation that you have revealed for us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Grant unto us all an understanding of your love, that we may welcome your amazing grace. We thank you especially that by Jesus' death, he has defeated the power of death. And by Jesus' resurrection from the dead, he has opened your kingdom to all believers. O God, all that you have given us is yours. As you first gave these beloved to us, so now we give them back to you. Receive by grace your children, our beloved, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
The peace of God, passing all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. invite you to join in our hymn, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is but not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
God bless All Saints Sunday. Bless all the families that are affected. Bless friends that knew these people. And we give thanks that they are now resting in heaven with you. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We offer our minds and bodies to you, O God.
Blessed are you, O God, with your word and Holy Spirit, create all things and all that are good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Jesus' suffering and death, took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever.
Thank you, God, for loving us. Amen.
We're now invited to give of ourselves and our tithes and our resources to God's church and God's work through this church. I invite you to give through all of the many ways that are options. We have Venmo and we have the plate being passed.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Please join me in the opening prayer. Let's pray in unison. Dear God,
we have come before you with all that we have. Please receive our bodies, minds, and souls as living sacrifices. Amen. Shalom to you now, shalom, my friends. May God's mercies bless you, my friends, in all your living and through your loving. Christ be your shalom. Christ be your shalom.
And now, living saints of God, go from this place knowing that God is faithful both in life and in death. Go in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The time has come, O Lord, for us to leave this place. Guide us and protect us and lead us in thy grace. Wherever life may take us, as we go our separate ways, help us share with others the things we've shared today.
May the peace of God the Father and the love of Christ his Son guide us in the days ahead and strengthen us each one. May the blessings of the Spirit fill us from within. God bless us and return us to this fellowship once again.